This week on Cracked Science, we talk about people who fear vaccines. And no, I'm not talking about anti-vaxxers. Hey, this is Jonathan Jerry, and you're watching Cracked Science, a show from the McGill Office of Science and Society that separates sense from nonsense on the scientific stage. Looking at recent headlines, you could be forgiven for thinking that you went to sleep one night in 1952, dreamt of a whole future, and now you've finally woken up again and it's still 1952. I mean, anti-Semitic hate crimes are in the news every week, teenagers can't think of anything cooler to do than inhaling nicotine, and oh yeah, measles is back. You know, the highly contagious viral disease that causes a fever, a rash, and in some children, pneumonia, seizures, blindness, brain inflammation, and death? There is an outbreak of measles in the US right now, affecting at least 159 individuals. In 2014, 4 years after the disease was declared eliminated from the US, there were 667 cases of it in America. And so I want to help us understand what is happening. And I think this graph speaks volumes on the issue of vaccines being a victim of their own success. As vaccine coverage goes up, the line in red, the number of people with the disease goes down, the line in blue, until we reach a point where enough people are vaccinated that the disease is really rare. But because vaccines are not 100% safe, in much the same way that being in a moving car is never 100% safe, people start to notice the occasional side effect. And that leads to a loss of confidence in the vaccine. We see an outbreak of this disease because of low vaccination rates, and this usually, but not always, leads to a resurgence in public trust in the vaccine as people are scrambling for a solution that, well, had been there all along. Which is why we need to talk about the vaccine hesitant, as there may be one in your life and you may be wondering how to convince them that vaccines are indeed amazing and really safe. And I want to make it clear that I'm not talking about a very small, though vocal, minority of people that have been called anti-vaxxers. Vaccine hesitants represent a very diverse group of people who, for one reason or another, are hesitant about getting vaccinated or getting their children vaccinated. They may refuse one vaccine but accept another, they may want an alternate vaccination schedule for their child, or they may even accept all the vaccines on the right schedule but with a certain amount of anxiety. And it would be easy to label them as hippie granola parents or as gun-toting health libertarians, but the reality is they are quite the motley crew. You can think of them as voters who are sitting on the fence and who don't have a clear idea of who they want to help elect. They can swing an election when the votes are tight, and the vaccine hesitant can indeed swing a population away from being sufficiently protected against a disease to being quite vulnerable. A recent survey was done in Quebec to measure the size of this hesitancy, and out of the 2,600 plus mothers of newborn infants who answered, 15% had a high vaccine hesitancy score. 61% of all responders were concerned about serious negative effects of the vaccines, and over half were concerned that childhood vaccines might not be safe. We also have data for the whole of Canada, thanks to the Childhood National Immunization Coverage Survey from 2015. 66% of parents reported being concerned about potential vaccine side effects. So the question is, why? Why are people anxious about one of the most important and beneficial public health measures ever implemented? There is no one answer, but rather a long list of concerns, such as too many vaccines too soon, that it may make their child sick, or that pharmaceutical companies can't be trusted. And some of these fears will be there regardless of your media diet, because you want to protect your child and someone you barely know wants to stick a lot of needles in them, and that can really test your parental instinct. But there's an accelerant that turns this tepid flame into a wildfire, and that's disinformation. When pediatricians talk to parents about childhood immunizations, they are competing with well-funded anti-vaccination lobby groups and popular social media accounts like this one.
Dr. Timpany, let's talk about vaccines a little
bit. Oh, gosh.
Good topic.
How many hours do we have to cover this one?
I know for a fact that my kids right now got a lot more than I did when I was their age. Are these safe?
No. Next question.
Next question.
YouTube and Pinterest are starting to take action, but this ongoing campaign of disinformation has been working. That Canadian immunization survey I mentioned earlier, it revealed that 15% of responders believe that naturopathy and chiropractic care can replace vaccines, which the authors had to add, quote, is not true. So Let's say there's a young parent in your life. Let's call her Brianna. She has expressed doubts about vaccines and you want to reach her. What do you do? Well, there have been many scientific studies looking at precisely that. And the good news is we know what doesn't work. We know that overselling the safety of vaccines can backfire. After all, you only need one example of someone who was hurt by vaccines to disprove the argument. Vaccines are very safe, but they're not 100% safe, so we shouldn't say they are. So how do we educate the public? A 2017 study compared three different interventions to promote vaccinations, contrasting myths with facts, illustrating the risks, and showing images of sick, unvaccinated children. This was done in Italian and Scottish students, and the results were that not only did it not work, it often backfired and made things worse. Then there was Brendan Nyhan's famous study that compared four methods and that concluded that none of it worked, some of it backfired, and that current public health communications about vaccines may not be effective. Anyone in science communication remembers the day the study came out as the day the music died. Screw this, nothing works, let's open a Dairy Queen and once a week we'll give people free ice cream. So you scream into the void and start sharing memes like this one, go vaccinate your kid or I'll punch you again, ha ha. Or this one, Uber, for anti-vaxxers, get it? Because they're dying of vaccine-preventable infections. Or this one that I can't even fully say because I work for a university but which calls parents who don't vaccinate their kids effing idiots. And I get it. Social media can be used to vent frustration and gain approval. But these sorts of memes, telling people who don't immunize their kids that they shouldn't be parents, they backfire too. They increase the polarization around the issue, make people feel condescension. And even if the target is anti-vaxxers and not the vaccine-hesitant parents will be affected by them. Because, as a Canadian paper on this problem reminds us, people rarely change their minds because someone called them stupid and wrong. Which brings me to hope.
The mission of Boost Oregon is to educate parents and the general public about the safety and benefits of children's vaccines. We have the cornerstone of our education, which is our community workshops. These are two-hour sessions led by a pediatrician or an epidemiologist. It's free for parents to attend. It's a warm, welcoming, safe space. And in that session, they ask their questions and they get answers without fear, without judgment, and all evidence-based responses.
Nadine Gardner, who started Boost Oregon, learned that debunking misinformation is a delicate art. It doesn't work with bulldozers. Vaccine-hesitant parents aren't opposed to vaccines. They're scared. And they want to be heard. The Day the Music Died paper had one big flaw. It tried to convince people online and not face-to-face. So here's a list of three things that can work when addressing the Briannas in your life. One, if you want to have a long conversation with Brianna and she has been exposed to a lot of anti-vaccine propaganda disguised as science, you will need to know what she means by EPA guidelines for the consumption of ethyl mercury and that 1976 swine flu vaccine. I would refer you to the site Anti-Anti-Vax, which lists common and not so common arguments against vaccines and exactly why they are invalid. Two, parents are important allies. Numbers don't reassure people, but stories do. If you have children, don't be shy to talk about them and about why you decided to vaccinate them. Share your story on Facebook. There is great power in learning about the uneventful vaccination. And if you're looking for stories of parents who have dealt with vaccine-preventable illnesses, check out immunize.org/reports, which contains numerous stories that deserve to be shared. And finally, and perhaps most importantly, listen. Use empathy. Show respect. A model that has been proposed for discussing the vaccine hesitancy is the motivational interview model. Asking the other person, what are your thoughts on vaccines? And listening. Telling them that you understand where they're coming from. Summarizing their concerns as you hear them. And then you can talk about the science of vaccination and your own anecdote. Being kind works. Here's Nadine Gardner from Boost Oregon with a story of her own. At one workshop, an anti-vaccine activist aggressively interrupted our educator and threw every possible anti-vaccine trope at him. He stayed cool and answered them point by point, which frustrated the activist and prompted her to walk out. I was nervous that this encounter would stoke fears among the expectant families in attendance. but it actually turned them against the activist's viewpoint. They wanted a deliberate, non-defensive conversation, not a screaming match. Try to be nice and never fail to be kind. I would highly recommend you check out Boost Oregon's website at boostoregon.org. They have a 10-minute video that explains their approach, as well as a parent's guide to vaccines, which you can find under For Parents, Parent Resources. Highly recommended to anyone who is anxious at the thought of getting their kids vaccinated. If you haven't subscribed to our YouTube channel, do click that button and ring that bell to get notifications. Don't forget to join the thousands of people who subscribe to our weekly newsletter by going to mcgill.ca/OSS. In the meantime, you can follow me on Twitter at CrackedScience and join us next time for science that may or may not be all it's cracked up to be.